Hello guys, Assalamu alaikum. Today I am going to deliver the lecture on the hydrocephalus or ventricular megaly, and this is very common in the obstetrics, and this is very common also for the case presentation in the exams. So how do you evaluate the case of the hydrocephalus and manage this case? This is very common. So let's see what is the hydrocephalus, how it forms, and what are the causes of the hydrocephalus, how we manage this case. तो सबसे पहले हम लोग आएंगे इन द डेफिनेशंस एंड द प्रीवेलेंस हाउ वी डिफाइन द हाइड्रोकेफेलस वी विल डिफाइन द वेंट्रिकुलर मेगाली एज अ मेजरमेंट ऑफ द एट्रियम ऑफ अ पोस्टीरियर और एंटीरियर हॉर्न ऑफ द लेटरल वेंट्रिकल्स ऑफ मोर देन 10 मिलीमीटर एट एनी गेस्टेशनल एज सो द लेटरल वेंट्रिकल्स द एट्रियम ऑफ द लेटरल वेंट्रिकल इज मोर देन 10 mm एट एनी गेस्टेशन और एनलार्जमेंट ऑफ द इंट्राक्रैनियल वेंट्रिकुलर सिस्टम ऑफ मोर देन 10 mm सो दिस इज द पिक्चर द अल्ट्रासाउंड पिक्चर व्हिच शोस द नॉर्मल and the hydrocephalic head. So what see here, look here, this is the normal atrium of the lateral ventricles. This is the dilated, this is the mock dilated or severely dilated. So when that is the more than 10 mm, but less than, up to the 15, this is called mild to moderate. If it's more than 15, that is called the severe hydrocephalus. So a severe ventricular megaly. The term hydrocephalus is used when there is increased pressure within the system and the head can be large. So when there is a pressure is increased and the head size is enlarged, we call it the hydrocephalus. Prevalence of the ventricular megaly between 0.3 and 1.5 per 1,000 birth. Now we see how this fluid is formed and from where it is formed. The cerebral spinal fluid is produced by modified capillaries, we call it the choroid plexus, and these choroid plexus are located in the lateral third and fourth ventricle. Look this is the picture of the human brain, this is the ventricular system, this is the anterior lateral ventricle, this is the lateral ventricle, this is the lateral ventricle, this is the lateral ventricle. This is the third ventricle and this is the fourth ventricle. So this is the four ventricle in the human brain and the fluid is formed by the choroid plexus. These are located in the ventricle. This is the lateral, this is the lateral. This is the third ventricle and this is the fourth ventricle. So these choroid plexus will form the fluid and this fluid will drain into the cisterna magna via the foramen of Meckendi and the Leschka. They circulate up and around the brain in the subarachnoid space and passively absorbed into the venous system via arachnoid villi. The cells of the ventricle communicate with the subarachnoid space only through the three foramina of the four ventricles. They are foramina of Meckendi and the Leschka. So this fluid will drain and then reabsorb. So if there is any problem in its reabsorption, or if there is any problem in the drainage of the system, means there is obstruction, it can lead to the dilatation of these ventricles and the hydrocephalus. So how we classify it, what are types of the hydrocephalus on the basis of the size of the atrium? They classify into the three types: mild, moderate and the severe. What happens in the mild, when the mild hydrocephalus is labeled, if there is atrium is more than 10 mm and the cortical thickness is more than 1 cm with the normal biparietal diameter. While the moderate, when the lateral ventricle size is the 12.1 to 15.0 mm. While in the severe, the size is more than 15 mm and the cortical thickness is less than 10 cm and there is abnormal enlargement of the biparietal diameter. So it could be unilateral or bilateral, symmetrical or asymmetrical. Why it occurs, what are its causes? So mostly it's related to the viral infection during intrauterine life, which includes the toxoplasmosis, parvovirus, CMV and rubella. The chromosomal abnormalities, some genetic problem like the X-linked recessive aqueductal stenosis, which is affecting the male fetus especially. They carry the risk 1 in 4 and if there is the recurrence risk, that is 1 in 2. And the other genetic abnormality that is very rare but may occur, that is the cerebral agenesis. So it is related to the genetic, may running in the family and affects the male fetus. So we are very careful when we are taking the history from the patient. So we must rule out the family history of the hydrocephalus and sex of the baby. when the patient is coming in your antenatal clinic with the ultrasound report, sometimes there are two types of the patient. The one patient who are coming with the ultrasound report, that shows that she is in a hydrocephalus. She knows about it. The second type of the patient who are coming in the labor room, they don't have the ultrasound report. They don't know about the hydrocephalus and they are neglected cases and they are coming with the obstructed labor. So in dono cases mein difference hai. Hum kaise isko aage le jayenge? The women who are coming in the antenatal clinics and having an ultrasound report, it shows that she is in a hydrocephalus and she is very worried and she is attending the antenatal clinic for the termination of the pregnancy. How we approach this type of the cases? We have to take in a detailed history regarding anomaly scan. So anomaly scan, so detailed history of the recent viral illness, parvovirus, toxoplasmosis, rubella, or syphilis. So we have to ask about these virus. Even the CME virus can cause this hydrocephalus. So we have to ask about the flu-like symptoms, the sore throat, arthralgia, fever, and the flu-like, other flu-like symptoms. So we have to rule out all of these symptoms. Any significant maternal trauma, any family or genetic history, are the family history of the hydrocephalus running in the families, any previous congenital abnormality of the babies, fetal neonatal thrombocytopenia, any history of the amniocentesis, because for the karyotyping, sometimes she may opt for karyotyping, so sometimes karyotyping is done via amniocentesis. We have to ask about the amniocentesis, the medical problem she has, the diabetes, hypertension, cardiac problem. So you rule out the detailed history, but these are the special points we may not miss in the diagnosis. So on the examination, usually the head is larger, its head circumference is more than 50 centimeter, globular and soft than the normal head. The head is higher up and possible to push into the pelvis if she is coming into the later stage or late trimester. The fetal heart is situated higher up above the umbilicus. On pervaginal examination during the labor, if there is gaping sutures and spontaneity and crackling sensation on pressing the head. Ultrasound shows a cranial shadows globular rather than the normal ovoid. Spontaneity and sutures are white. Walled bones are thinner. The lateral and third ventricles are dilated. More thinning of the cerebral cortex. Look this. This is the severe hydrocephalus. This is the choroid plexus. These are the choroid plexus. This is the dilated hydrocephalus. And the BPD is 9.4. This is the picture which shows the normal. This is the hydrocephalus. So this is the severe hydrocephalus. This is the mild to moderate, and this is the normal. This bright echogenic structures. These are the choroid plexus. These are the bright echogenic structures. This is the choroid plexus. How we do the workup of this woman? उसकी हमने क्या इन्वेस्टिगेशन करानी है, क्या क्या करवाना है. सो डिटेल्ड स्कैन इन द टर्शियरी केयर हॉस्पिटल और वी रिफर दिस टाइप ऑफ द पेशेंट्स टू द फीटल मेडिसिन यूनिट. इफ द फीटल मेडिसिन यूनिट इज नॉट अवेलेबल हियर इन आवर फैसिलिटीज और पेशेंट इज नॉट अफोर्डिंग, देन वी हैव टू एडवाइस फॉर द डिटेल्ड स्कैन, नॉर्मली स्कैन, स्पेशली फॉर द अदर एसोसिएटेड एबनॉर्मेलिटीज, बिकॉज इन there is most common, because this is associated with the other abnormalities. Most common associated abnormality is the spina bifida, that is 25 to 30% in the cases. It is followed by the other defect like CNS, renal, GIT, that is in 7 to 15% of the. Sometime examiner may ask the percentage of the spina bifida or other abnormalities. Viral studies for toxoplasmosis, parvovirus, CMV, rubella from the maternal serum and also from the amniocentesis. So we send the amniotic fluid for the karyotyping and for viral PCR. Karyotyping should be discussed. There is 7 to 15% overall risk of the aneuploidies. Although the risk of chromosomal abnormalities for isolated unilateral ventriculomegaly is extremely low. If the ventriculomegaly is associated with an intracerebral hemorrhage, the evidence of the fetal alloimmune thrombocytopenia should be sought. Antiplatelet antibodies should be advised. Fetal MRI should be arranged for further review, and the pediatric neurologist must be essential. For isolated unilateral ventriculomegaly, additional brain abnormalities are detected by fetal MRI in 5% and 6% of the cases, prenatally and postnatally respectively. So this is the workup. Before going to management, you must ask in the exam. Agar examiner aapko bolta hai, what investigation would you like to ask? Apart from the routine investigation, jisa aap log mangte ho na, exam mein the CBC chahiye, RBS chahiye, urine detailed report chahiye, blood group chahiye, viral marker chahiye, hepatitis B, C, HIV, and the rubella status. You have to ask about whether she has any screening for the toxoplasmosis, whether she has any investigation regarding the toxoplasmosis, or the CMV virus, toxoplasmosis, syphilis, or the parvovirus. And you have to ask about the amniocentesis, whether my patient undergoing amniocentesis or karyotyping and the fetal MRI. You must ask all these investigations from the examiner once you are asking regarding the investigations. So how will you manage this case? The management depends upon the gestational age at the diagnosis, presence of the other associated abnormalities, results of the karyotyping, results of the viral screening, and the parental vision. So if the diagnosis is made prior to the fetal viability or severe degree of the hydrocephalus, or there is associated with other abnormalities, or there is chromosomal abnormalities, spina bifida, or other major abnormalities, so in these cases, patient may consider the pregnancy termination. If the diagnosis is made after viability or the couple choosing to continue with the pregnancy, and if it's isolated or it's mild to moderate variety, then in these cases, serial scans to follow the progress and or regress. Attempt to carry the pregnancy until the fetal lung maturity. If the patient wants to carry in a pregnancy, there is an isolated, then we have to continue the pregnancy till the fetal lung maturity. So when it is delivered, if severe, we have to opt the termination at any time. If not severe, if there is mild hydrocephalus or moderate hydrocephalus, is isolated, not associated with the chromosomal abnormalities or other major malformation, we have to continue till the maturity. So if for any indication, if the baby is delivered before that, we have to give the steroids cover. Mode of delivery, that's also depend upon the standard obstetrical criteria. In the presence of the severe macrocephaly, caesarean section or kyphosynthesis may be required, but the kyphosynthesis is associated with a high incidence of the procedural or intrapartum demise. The principle is to decompress the hydrocephalic head in labor, either in vortex or in breech presentation. So in the breech presentation, that is 30% is in the hydrocephalus, the 30% cases of breech. So kyphosynthesis prior to delivery, empty the bladder, it must be empty the bladder. So kyphosynthesis, how we do it? Principle is to decompress the hydrocephalic head in labor, either in vertex or in breech. This is also done during cesarean delivery before incising the uterus. So in the cesarean, we have to take care before giving incision to the uterus, we have to decompress the head. Bladder is evacuated beforehand. Once the labor is established and the cervix is 3 to 4 cm dilated, decompression of the head is done by a sharp pointed scissor or with a wide bore, 20 gauge long needle. If the patient who is in a breech presentation, it can be done by abdominal decompression of the head, the kyphosynthesis through abdominal route using a large bore needle under ultrasound guidance, or per vaginally. So when the baby is delivered and after coming head is arrested, when the arrested head, so sometimes these women are presented as a neglected case, and even the doctor don't know about the hydrocephalus, or the mother don't know about the hydrocephalus, and she come in the labor with advanced labor with a arrested head. So in these cases, the decompression is done by perforating the suboccipital region using a needle or a sharp pointed scissor under guidance of the two fingers of the left hand, protecting the anterior vaginal wall. Exploration of the uterus must be done. Look this, after the delivery, the exploration of the uterus must be done after the delivery to see any tear to the uterus or any rupture of the uterus or an injury to the uterus. This is very important. So if there is any role of the ventricular amniotic shunt, the intrauterine ventricular amniotic shunt, but the placement of the tube between the fetal ventricular system and the amniotic cavity, it potentially reduces the pressure, but this is experimental tell. After the delivery, there is role of the ventricular amniotic shunt. It will improve when this occurs. Outcome is better if performed for 6 months of the age. if the operative treatment is not delayed, most cases of the hydrocephalus are compatible with the normal physical development and normal head size. Complication of the shunt may be infection, hematoma, blockage, and the seizure. What's the prognosis? So when the examiner asks you about the prognosis, or when the mother is asking about you regarding the prognosis of the baby, you must involve the pediatrician. You must involve the pediatrician and say that, you have to go to the pediatrician. He will tell you about the afterlook of the baby. So whether any other underlying problems are found, such as chromosomal abnormalities, the size of the ventricle is moderate to severe, or whether the enlargement is progressive. In these cases, the prognosis is really poor. So if the hydrocephalus is progressive, severe type, so with associated with the chromosomal abnormalities, in these cases, usually the fetus is born dead or stillborn, and or may die into the neonatal periods. Those who survive suffer developmental delay, but in less than 30%, they may be normal. The place of the ventricular aortic shunt is limited at the present. Isolated mild ventriculomegaly is the good prognosis. What's the maternal prognosis? If the mother knows about the hydrocephalus, then there's a good prognosis. If she don't know about the hydrocephalus, so she may become as a neglected, uncared. She may be end up with the obstetric labor with complications may occur. Rupture may occur even before the cervix is fully dilated, because of the too much stretching of the lower segment by the head. Recurrence rate. Women usually ask, what's the recurrence rate? Doctor saab, mere dusra bachcha to aisa nahi hoga. So, ye aksar bahut hi common question hai. Doctor saab, mere dusre bachche ko to aisa nahi hoga. You have to tell that recurrence rate is about 5%. Har 100 में से 5 बच्चों में ये दोबारा से हो सकता है. So, genetic counseling is very important. If it's X-linked recessive, doctor schemosis, it carries 1 in 4 risk of the recurrence for future pregnancies and 1 in 2 risk of the male fetuses. Cerebellar agenesis, though it's very rare, but may occur. So it carries also the same recurrence rate. So it's very important to counsel the woman regarding the genetic counseling. For history, may family history, previous siblings history, zarur leni. Any question? I would be happy to answer you. Thank you.